Good morning. Welcome to the Outside of the Box Children Parenting Series here at Laura's Library. It's nice to see all of you here, and for those of you joining at home, we welcome you as well. As we all know, raising a child of any type is an art form, but raising a child who does not fit neatly into any particular box is a particularly messy art. Parents often ask themselves, what is going on with my child? How can I help? How can the schools help? Am I the only one? We created this series to help connect parents to one another and to the resources available in our community. We meet on the first Wednesday of every month throughout the school year here at Laura's Library. We cover a variety of topics related to children who are outside of the box, and our speakers this year have all been live streamed and archived on the library's YouTube channel. Today, we are delighted to present Susan Phariss to help us understand how to reduce frustration and anxiety here at home. Susan Phariss is a neurodevelopment consultant, primitive reflex specialist, engineer, and brain development expert. Susan performed one of the first controlled studies using neurodevelopmental movements to help kids overcome behavior and learning challenges. She specializes in helping bright kids who struggle with sensory issues and anxiety with her proven step-by-step process that stimulates higher brain function. She is also a neurodevelopmental consultant to private schools and early childhood development organizations. Susan believes it is possible to change the brain and profoundly improve the future at a level that most people never imagine. Without further ado, Susan Phariss.
Thank you. All right, so we've got, welcome to the people at home, and thank you guys for coming. And I want to start off with finding out, what are your needs? What are the challenges that you're faced with, so that I can try to address them during this talk? So that would be, we're talking about frustration, we're talking about anxiety, and what else are your bigger challenges at home? And I'm going to be writing these down, so if anybody has any that they want to start with, I can start with, one of the big ones is shoes and socks. That can cause major meltdowns before school, during school, after school, all kinds of things like that. What other issues are you guys dealing with that are your top priorities?
Brushing teeth.
Brushing teeth. Ooh, that's a good one.
Especially in the morning.
Okay. What are some other sources of frustration in the house?
Homework.
So talk to me more about homework. Is it about how long it takes to get it done? Is it just fighting doing it? What? Be specific.
Well, sort of my child has ADD, so it's kind of hard getting him to start and then keeping him on task.
Okay, so I'm going to put starting homework and staying on task.
How about also organizing homework and, like, you know, taking responsibility for back?
Okay, so say it one more time.
So it's like organizing their homework, coming home and, you know, pulling out their stuff, knowing what they have to do.
And turning it in?
Yes.
Okay. What else? Nobody has more frustrated. There we are.
Any change in routine?
Changes in routine. Yeah, that's a good one.
Eating.
Picky eater.
Yes.
Staying at the table.
Yes.
Okay.
Sibling rivalry. Sibling interactions.
Okay, I got room for one or two more.
Going back to changes in routine, we have problems when there's a substitute teacher for the day.
Any others? That's plenty to play with, right? Okay, so I want to start with the big picture of how does the brain develop in the first place, that when a baby's born, they automatically know how to do things. They know how to nurse. They figure out how to roll over in the crib. They figure out how to crawl. They figure out how to walk. They aren't taught how to do that. Those are reflexes. Specifically, they're called primitive reflexes. So primitive reflexes, their sole purpose is brain development from conception to age 3. That's all they're there for. They are there to, it's a physical reflex, and each reflex triggers brain growth in a very specific part of the brain. So, for instance, everybody's seen the grasp reflex. You put something in a baby's hand, it has to grab it. That's the grasp reflex. And then later, to finish off that reflex, they throw, which is letting go. If that reflex doesn't get finished, welcome to the world of hoarding. Welcome to not being able to hang on to good relationships, not being able to let go of bad ones. It is, there is a manifestation of it as an adult that people don't realize it started with these reflexes. So all of these primitive reflexes, there's, last count I saw, there's 89 primitive reflexes that are responsible for physically developing the brain. It is not In those first 3 years, we're talking about the organ of the brain. We are physically getting it to grow in very specific areas, strategic areas of the brain. And if they don't get to move in the way that they need to, we don't get the brain development in the area that we want. So an example of that would be that some babies, they say kids in an orphanage in another country, they may spend an inordinate amount of time in a carrier, like a car carrier, and in restricted from moving. And since all of the original brain development is based on movement, if you restrict their movement, you are preventing brain development. It's black and white. It's not a iffy. This is the way the brain develops, is through movement. So all the crawling, all the rolling over, all the little rocking movements that they make, those are the system that builds the brain in the first place. Now, when everything goes right, these reflexes, the primitive reflex system, I call it the original operating system, it operates from conception to age 3. Then they're all supposed to turn off and get stored in the brainstem. And then the adult postural reflexes take over. What happens if they don't get to finish off at age 3 for whatever reason is now you've got two operating systems running at the same time. So if your computer had two operating systems running at the same time, neither one of them is going to work very well. And the primitive reflexes, when they are still on during the adulthood, they literally sabotage you. So they prevent you from being able to do what you need to do. And that can be in a variety of ways, many of which we're going to talk about today. So I'm going to move this out of the way to explain this a little bit better. Okay, let's put this over here. Okay, so let's talk, before the meeting, some people were talking about executive brain function, which is really important throughout life. Executive brain function, it's one of our most valuable things that we're trying to develop in our kids. And let me talk a little bit about how that works. So this represents PFC, prefrontal cortex. That is the good part of your brain that is making the good decisions. And that actually takes technically 26 years to finish developing. And who figured that out? The car insurance companies, right? They were able to figure out that at that point, now we've got impulse control, and it's pretty black and white, everybody knows. So we were teasing before the meeting about how kids have to borrow their parents' prefrontal cortex until they're about 26 in order to have a good functioning life. But let's keep going here. So this represents our limbic system, or the emotional part of the brain. So when you're born, there's almost no connection there whatsoever. So a baby has an emotion, it expresses it. They feel like crying, they cry. They want something, they want it now. This is normal to a certain age, right? Then we've got, if things go right, now we've got the prefrontal cortex. We've got our emotional center. And now we've got a huge connection here, okay? So we want to go from dial-up to broadband. So an example of this would be a boy in the lunch line. Somebody bumps into him, he turns around, punches the kid. Then he gets sent to the principal's office. Principal calls mom, mom gets there, takes him home. 30 minutes has elapsed. And it's about then that it dawns on him, maybe they weren't trying to pick a fight. Maybe that was a mistake. It literally took 30 minutes for this impulse, this emotional impulse, to go to the prefrontal cortex, get feedback, and come back to the emotional center. This is a physical connection here. This is not trying harder. This is not something you learn. This is a physical connection that we must build. So you do strategic exercises to build this part of the brain. 3 months later, same kid in the lunch line, after he's done these exercises, somebody bumps into him, he turns around, sees that it's nothing, and goes back to his conversation. We have immediate communication. So everybody starts here, not everybody gets here. And this is one of the key things that we work on, because it is so important for people to understand that impulse control, executive function, it is a physical development. It is not trying harder. You can try harder all day long. Until you have this development, you are not going to have impulse control. You're not going to be able to stay on task. You know, you're not really going to be able to organize. You're certainly not going to remember to turn it in, because you just flat out don't have this going on. You got an impulse. Oh, I'm going to go play now. I'd like to go do this. I'd like to go do that. There is none of this feedback coming back. We can do that as soon as we finish. This is important. I'm going to get it done. This is brain development. We need physical brain development in order to get where we need to go. So on that list, this is sensory, this is sensory, this is executive brain function. This is it's going to come back to sensory also, and I'm going to explain that in just a second. Sensory. This is a little bit different. This is a particular reflex that siblings cannot get along with. If this one reflex is still turned on past its useful age, we're going to have not fun relationships. I was one of those kids. My brother and I, we hated each other throughout childhood. I mean, we never, ever got along. There are no pictures of us looking happy together. We never, ever got along. And then substitute teachers, that is more about the executive brain function and adaptability, which also comes back to sensory. So let's go talk about sensory for just a minute. And those of you who are here, ask me questions. You know, when a question comes up, ask me then so that I can answer that question and you don't walk home without it answered. And there is a handout about this on the table at the back of the room. Okay, sensory. So let's get, again, we're going to start with big picture and then we're going to come back to details. Big picture is, that this is a really strong lid on this. Okay, the big picture is, in the end, our nervous system, we want to have fight or flight. This is it's going to keep us alive in a challenging situation. Fight or flight, that's where we want to end up with. But how do we get there? Babies aren't born with fight or flight. So what we're going to start with is down here, fear paralysis reflex. This is done in the womb. So the movements that you feel in the womb, that's fear paralysis reflex. The babies are, and we've got, you know, all these different scans and videos that show fetuses actually doing these. We use these exact movements. So it's things like just opening their arms, or just nodding their head, or just moving one leg up the other. There's a specific set of, I think there's like 14 distinct movements that all fetuses make in the womb to do this reflex. And what the reflex is it's a withdrawal reflex, that when the fetus is startled, it withdraws and freezes. So this is the beginning of flight, right? We're just starting to touch flight. We're withdrawing from the danger, okay? That's step one. Step two is the Moro reflex. So fear paralysis is supposed to turn off before they're born. Each reflex has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And so this one is supposed to turn off, and this one's supposed to turn on, and it's before birth, and then it goes on after birth for some months, and then it should turn off too. So Moro reflex, its job is to calibrate the senses. So when you're born, your senses are, let's say they're at 100, so smell, touch, light, balance, proprioception, all of your senses are way out there. They're 100, so it's totally overwhelming. So when they come out, things are too loud, too bright, things touch are too hard, getting moved is really difficult. You've all seen the Moro reflex when the baby's asleep and you start to put them down and you go a little bit too fast and they go and start crying. That's Moro reflex, this, and then crying. So its job, when it gets to finish, the sensory input is calibrated down to like 40% of what it was, a manageable amount. And they don't all happen at the same time. It's not all or nothing. I've seen kids that just had one sense that was out, way hypersensitive. Everybody else had come back in. And then we see other kids that it's all of them. So Moro, the other thing that comes with Moro is aggression. So this one, this one is a precursor to fight. So between these two reflexes, step one, step two, step three, fight or flight, healthy reflex. So nowadays you often hear fight, flight, or freeze. It's because this guy's still turned on. And the aggression, so hitting, biting, kicking, those are normal behaviors at a certain age. And then they should turn off and go away. So we frequently work with kids that are hitters and biters and kickers, and we do the movements for these two reflexes, because these are the foundation of everything else. We work on these two reflexes, and we get the hitting and kicking and biting thing down pretty quickly. Within about a month, we've got it down to a very manageable level, or if at all. So we stimulate, we do the movements associated with these. We literally do the same movements that fetuses and babies make in the first year of life. And that triggers growth in a strategic part of the brain so that it finishes developing. That's what we want, is we just want a healthy, normal, developed brain. There are many different reasons why these don't get finished. Electromagnetic frequencies. Those can influence people. Any kind of toxin. So for me, I have mercury poisoning, and that keeps this one running past its normal lifespan. Glutens trigger this one and this one, but it's a pair. You rarely ever see one without the other. They come together. So there are And any kind of trauma, extreme trauma, whether that's a toxin, a car accident, death in the family, these are going to turn back on. And that's part of our the amazing system that we are, is that this software for building the brain can be rebooted at any age. So whether it's a 10-year-old that's got dyslexia or ADD or OCD, or an 85-year-old who's had a stroke, we do the same movements. It develops the brain in that area, and the symptoms are remediated. Now, some people are going to have to keep doing these because, like me, until I get all the mercury out of my body, this one is quietly running in the background. Because I do these movements with clients, I don't have to do them on my own. And some clients, they're able to work these and then they're done. They're good. The reflexes get stored back in the brainstem, and they're good. They're functioning, happy people. And some people, this one's going to hang on because of sensitivity to EMFs or whatever the trigger is for these different reflexes. So these two are the foundation for everything else. All the reflexes that come after this, which are responsible for building vision, depth of field, reading, all of those, all of the skills required for higher brain function for learning, their foundation's right here. And then we go up, then we keep developing more. So, for example, for dyslexia, the reflex that allows them to roll over in the crib, that's the reflex that causes the most trouble with dyslexia. And we're able to go in and do the movements that are associated with that reflex, and now we've got kids that have instant ability to focus from near to far and far to near. That's part of this game. My husband, Paul, let me give you a quick story about Paul, and because it's very pertains to reading, is that when Paul was six, he died in a swimming accident. And he was tagged, his parents were told he was dead. And then the coroner came in and found a beating heart. So Paul had extensive brain damage, and he did go to public schools, and he spent most of his time in school in reading clinic, which wasn't in his school. He had to bus across town to go to reading clinic. So all through school, reading clinic, his reading didn't change at all. He, at that point, you could graduate from high school. So they said he had a fourth grade reading level with zero comprehension. That means you can't read. What's the point? So when we got together, I don't remember how old we were, in the 40s, Paul still couldn't read. So no billboards, no street signs, still couldn't read. And he'd become a professional juggler, because jugglers don't have to learn how to read. And not just a professional juggler, gold medalist, world champion juggler. So he traveled all over the world and worked in all these different places entertaining people as a juggler, but didn't have to read. So when we got together, still couldn't read, and we ended up writing a book about how juggling changes the brain. Because at that point, when we were writing the book, all these different universities were getting brain scanning equipment. It was brand new, because this is like 10 years ago. And so these universities were using juggling as a gross motor skill to measure brain growth. And what they found is that 7 days of learning how to juggle, not juggling, learning how to juggle, they could measure new brain cell growth in 7 days. They found that it develops it in the visual processing center and a lot of other places. But there were study after study after study that proved that it grew new gray matter and it grew new white matter, which is what the purpose of these reflexes is to connect the brain. So the brain, when you're born, you got this gray matter, not much white matter that connects everything, not much in the way of neural pathways. These reflexes, all these little baby movements that they make, they are building the connecting tissue, all of the neural pathways. That is their purpose, is to build the neural pathways. So writing the book, I was researching, and I thought, well, what other movement-based therapies are out there for the brain? And I found the one that we ended up becoming practitioners in. It's called Blomberg Rhythmic Movement Training. And it was a Swedish psychiatrist that came up with the system, that developed the system. And it's all based on the movements infants make in the first year of life, that you can do those movements again at any age, it will trigger that brain growth. So when I read about it on the internet, I had an inner knowing I have never had before that I knew that this was the answer for Paul. And at that point, there were three people in North and South America doing it. So we became clients right away. We drove out of state and got our sessions. And the effect was so profound on both of us that we had to become practitioners. So for Paul, we were studying to be in a play in the local church. And we went to the first reading, and he couldn't find his place in the script or anything. We did the training, and we came back and started practicing on the script. And for the first time in his life, a paragraph was in focus. Now, there's no way he could have told us before that happened that things weren't in focus, that things were moving all around the page. But after getting that jump in brain development, a connection that made things work better, now a whole paragraph is in focus. And then when we did more of our training and learned more about the reflex that is responsible for dyslexia, we went out to dinner one night after class. He opened the menu, and for the first time in his life, everything was in focus. And before that, I had to read menus to him because he couldn't read them. So that's how we personally found out about this. And then my story was, first husband died, all the primitive reflexes turned on because it was so traumatic. And I couldn't file anything, I couldn't organize anything, I had panic attacks, phobias, I stayed home all the time, I became a hermit. And when we found this for Paul, my life changed. My anxiety turned off because I had turned these guys on. And it totally sabotaged my life. I was president of Assistance Dogs International, which is the organization over all the guide service and hearing dog programs in the world. And I loved it. Oh my God, I loved it. And I was running a nonprofit training service dogs. Loved it. Couldn't do it. So for 10 years, my life was totally sabotaged until we found this program for Paul. And I thought, well, you know, if it's going to improve the brain, I'm in. Let me do it. And my life changed. So that's what brought us into this. And then since then, we've gotten to work with a lot of different kids with a lot of different issues and been able to get to remediate dyslexia, to remediate ADD, because these are all physical brain functions. So with the picky eater, that's sensory. So one of the things that we teach parents is, at what age would this behavior be appropriate? Well, when they're first nursing. They're not supposed to put anything else in their mouth. They're not supposed to want anything. So you can look and go, oh, okay. So developmentally, that particular part of their brain, it's an infant, just very, very young, at a nursing age. And the shoes and socks, you know, that's the tactile. That's absolutely this Moro issue. In fact, we just had got a little boy, where is he? Over almost Lakeway. And yeah, it was a nightmare every day to put the shoes and socks on. Shoes were one issue, socks were a separate issue. And then she just emailed me last night and said, I don't understand it, but it's over. It's over. So we've turned that off. We've calibrated that reflex. We've used the system that's already there to calibrate the symptoms down to a manageable level where it's supposed to be. So brushing teeth, same thing. This is a sensory issue. And when we turn that down, you don't have the resistance. Verbal fluency absolutely it's all about the reflexes. So we've had kids that were completely nonverbal and we got speech. And this is after they'd had 4 years of speech therapy. So we've had several kids where they were completely nonverbal, or I was putting in a neurodevelopment program in a private school over by Houston, and we had some kids that they were verbal, but you couldn't understand anything they said, or they could not get language. So it was me want that. And everybody's like, no, it's I. Well, she could never get it. And I mean, she'd been in the school for 2 or 3 years, so came in, did these movements, addressed the primitive reflex system, and it turns out this girl's bright. She took control of her. She ran her family. It was beautiful. Because these kids are so bright, and frequently people treat them like they're not bright. These are super bright kids that are getting sabotaged by the primitive reflexes. And you go in, you do the movements, which at the most is 20 minutes a day. Think about babies. They don't do anything very long. They do things for a few seconds at a time. So a long exercise might be, I think the longest we've ever done one is 2 minutes. And that's enough. You know, we do several rocking movements that it's pumping cerebrospinal fluid up and down the spine, it's hydrating the cerebellum, and it's physically building the cerebellum. The cerebellum, all of your senses except smell, go through the cerebellum before they're processed, and they go through the cerebellum before they're processed by the body. So if you don't have a robust, healthy, hydrated cerebellum, nice, plump, beautiful cerebellum, you're not getting all the signal. You're getting partial signals. That's not good enough. So a lot of the movements are just to address cerebellar issues. And you know, reading, I've got one client that dyslexia has been a major problem for her. And we just now got her cerebellum really working, so she's rhythmic. And she's just flying through her improvements. But it took months to get her cerebellum in action. And most of the time, when you address the primitive reflex system, it's taking a year or less, and then you're done. Then you're not going to a bunch of other therapies. You may continue a little bit with, they still have to learn how to read. They still need to learn the vocabulary and how to spell. But the brain development is there, that you're not having to go to OTs, you're not having to go to behaviorists, you're not having to go to them as much, because you have addressed the root cause. And if you're seeing somebody that you've been seeing for 8 years, and they're saying that they're addressing the primitive reflexes, I guarantee they're not doing it effectively. They may be doing it at some level, but it's not working, because the problem would be resolved in less than a year if, you know, I mean, I guess we've had a crack baby that was 14, and she couldn't go to school. And the primary reason they brought her to her was aggression. And her adopted mom was 70, and when she's 14, she's a big girl. And when she'd lose her temper, she'd get aggressive. And so she'd hit and push her mom down, and it was unacceptable behavior. They'd been getting 12 years of therapy before they found us, trying to get reading and numbers. She had no understanding of alphabet or numbers. So this is a girl who basically hung on her mom's apron strings, couldn't go to school, and had meltdowns. So within a year, she understood letters, she understood numbers, and in a year and a half, she was able to go to school. So these are really critical, that you address the primitive reflexes, and then somebody with as much brain damage as she had, she recovered. Paul, did you have a question?
Yeah, explain to them how long the aggression, it just was so quick.
Oh, the aggression, with her, I think it was literally 2 weeks before she stopped hitting her mom, because we addressed this, and the brain needed this to be addressed. I mean, she was 14, she was still doing it. It wasn't like, well, let's give it six more months and see if that works. If it's still going at 14, you got an issue that you really need to address at the root level, and that's what this guy is all about. So changes in routine. So if your senses are coming in at 100 there is a limitation to how much your brain can process at a time. And if it's processing way too much sensory input, there's very little left to process learning or even being comfortable in your skin. So these guys being turned on is the definition of anxiety. These guys being turned on is the definition of post-traumatic stress disorder. This is the symptoms. This is what causes that. The set of symptoms for PTSD, these are the root cause because it got turned on by the big trauma. So if you're extremely anxious because you've got too much sensory input, you don't have any room to handle changes in routine. You just don't have it. You're overwhelmed. You're totally overwhelmed. How could you possibly memorize anything or handle changes in routine or get your homework organized, stay on task? All of these things, anxiety, that's a killer to learning. It's really difficult to learn. So they're always in Moro, which is it's the precursor to fight or flight. That's always going on instead of their parasympathetic nervous system, which brings up a great point. Let's learn something to do, things you can actually do. So one of our activities is balancing a peacock feather. And what this does, when you do this activity, you're automatically using your peripheral vision. Your peripheral vision means that you're safe, and that turns on your parasympathetic nervous system, which is relax and recover. When you're in fight or flight, your sympathetic nervous system, your eyes are programmed to be scanning the horizon for danger, so they're not ready for up-close work. So reading, really, really hard when you're in fight or flight, or Moro, or fear paralysis. It's physically difficult. Go ahead and hand those out, Paul. It's physically difficult to focus up close. So when you've got kids that have anxiety or any of these reflexes, dyslexia, ADD, any of these things, if you'll have them balance a peacock feather before they do their reading, before they do their homework, before they go to school.
Turn off.
Ah, Paul, can you turn off the fan?
it's
really good challenge.
Ah,
see, I'm not having a problem with it now. I've done this a few years. I might have done this once or twice.
No, I haven't. Nathan does this, and I happen to know that, like, if he's outside and it's windy, or if you're under a fan, it will make a difference.
So what we have people do this for homework is balance the peacock feather, and your job as a parent is to say, look at the top, look at the top, look at the top. Because as soon as they get it, they're going to do this. And that's also teaches what concentration is. Concentration is an abstract word. This, if I'm not concentrating, it falls, teaches them. You're not teaching them. It's teaching them what concentration is. And it is physically, it does so many different things. It's building eye-hand coordination, it improves saccadic eye movement, it activates the parasympathetic nervous system, builds focus and concentration. It's got there's a longer list than that of the benefits of this very simple and fun activity. And that's part of the key, is that I think we read the other day, what was it, Paul? How many repetitions to learn something?
400 repetitions to learn something new, unless it's play.
So 400 repetitions to learn something
wow.
new, unless it's play, and then it just takes 10 or 20 repetitions to build that part of the brain. So we're using this to build that part of our brain, and like I said, I'm going to repeat it, do this before school so that they can get out the door in a good place, do that when they come home and they're exhausted because they've been trying so hard at school. Do this after that, do this before any reading assignments. And I put a chart out on the table for you to get that is something to put on the refrigerator so that they can see how long, what was their best time on the right hand. And I'll usually just count out loud, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, okay, your best time on your right hand today was 7, and the best time on your left hand was 13. Great, and then the next day we do it again and again and again. As soon as they can do 60 seconds on either hand, you're going to upgrade to a new challenge, the yardstick. The yardstick is much faster, much more challenging, and I recommend that you get some type of a sticker that they like and stick it all the way at the top to give them a focal point. Rather, the top of the stick is pretty hard to look at, so a point. And some of our kids, it's not very often, but some of our kids, we have to put like a little gem or a shiny sticker in here that is more of a focal point, that this isn't enough of a focal point for them. So if they're really having trouble continuing to look up here, add something smaller, about a half inch is ideal. Put that right there for them to do, and then you're the, again, look at the top, look at the top, look at the top, because they're not going to. Okay, so there's an activity for activating the parasympathetic nervous system. How's our time? We're doing good on time.
So,
yes?
My question, what is the progression from feather to yardstick? What is the yardstick giving in addition to the focus from the feather?
The yardstick is doing the same thing. It is more challenged so that they're going to keep doing it because it's going to get too easy and then it's just not fun anymore. And we got to keep it fun. So we had a little client in Alabama, I think it was, because we work with people by Skype. And he set up, he loved it. He set up an obstacle course with his yardstick. So he was going over things and under things and laying down and getting back up and jumping and balancing on one leg and hot, I mean, you name it. So when it got up to like 40 minutes, his parents were like, time it yourself. You know, we don't have time to time you, because he just got so good at it that he needed more of a challenge. And so if you've got one that needs more of a challenge, shorten the yardstick. You want to start with 36 inches. But then you can shorten it, and that's going to increase the degree of difficulty significantly. And I'd probably whack off about 3 inches, 4 inches at a time. It's going to be significant. Okay. Any other questions about yardstick? Yes. Uh-huh. Yes. Yes. Good. Okay. So she asked how, you know, are they supposed to move their hand? Is it supposed to stay still? So when you're starting, and let's say we've got an itty-bitty. So we've got somebody that with really either really poor coordination or they're three. And what you teach them is follow the feather. So it goes this way, your hand follows the feather. And then really quickly they will get it. If that's beyond them, you go ahead and you put the feather in between the fingers. It's still going to move around. They're still going to get the same benefit. Exactly the same benefit. We learned that from an elderly client in a wheelchair that she just figured it out on her own that she did this and she could stay in her wheelchair. So when you first start, you may be running all over the place, but the goal is, and that might be another degree of difficulty that you give to your kids, is to stand still. Is how well can you stand still and do this? That's better. And keep looking at the top. That's key, and that it's not normal for them to do that. You're going to have to help them do that, and that's building that focus and concentration.
At what point do they master the activity and feel, I mean, like at what point does that, is there, are they fully developed in that reflex? Or
so this is not technically addressing a reflex.
Okay.
This is activating the parasympathetic nervous system.
Okay.
And it is building eye-hand coordination and improving saccadic eye movement, but technically there are no baby movements doing this,
okay,
right?
Right.
So we're using it as another activity that gets us where we need to go. And especially the kids with a lot of anxiety, doing this before they do their work, it will shorten the amount of time. I mean, we've worked with kids that, actually several, it seems to be the running number, 4 hours to do homework at night, and then nobody else in the family can play because too much distraction and lots of crying. And they do these movements in about, I want to say 3 or 4 months, we're down to 40 minutes to get homework done. And then we've had some that don't even bring homework home anymore because they have a study hour and they're able to complete their work at school. So they don't bring the crying, I don't want to do homework home, because they've got enough brain development to stay on task. We just recently worked with how old is she, seven? 7-year-old who never got her work done, didn't turn anything in. They had to micromanage her, is how they talked about it. And we started doing the movements, and within just a few weeks, they discovered her going into her dad's office, doing all of her math homework and completing it. Okay, that's really weird. And then it was right, even weirder. So that was a shocker for us to see one. We hadn't seen one happen quite like that so quickly. And some of them are just, they're always a surprise. Let's be honest, they're always a surprise. We always see results. We just don't know when it's gonna happen. Okay, I'm gonna move on to the next thing. Another tool. I've got two more practical tools to share with you that you can take home and start using today. So the peacock feather, you're gonna keep that peacock feather and take it home. And remember, when they get to 60 seconds, both hands, upgrade to the yardstick. And it will be way more challenging initially. They'll may not like that, but they will really, really quickly. Okay, the next one I wanna teach is a technique called the wave. And here's what it is. Witness, acknowledge, validate, empower. This is a magnificent tool for young children and children who don't have this complete, that they don't have enough, they don't have impulse control. So the first one that we really experienced, it was so profound, was a little five-year-old, and his first week at school, they did a tornado drill. It was up in Oklahoma. And he became obsessed that his mom was going to get sucked up into the tornado and he'd never see her again. And he was truly obsessing on it. So a week went by and that's all he could think about or talk about. And so we saw him, and of course we did the same thing that everybody else did initially. We were like, oh, but your mom, she actually works in like the safest building in the city, because she did. There's no way she'll be fine there. Your mom's safe. We're not addressing the problem. So we learned this technique. So the next time I saw him and he says, you know, mom's gonna die. And I'm like, that's really scary. You're really scared. Yeah, I'm scared. And you just listen and let them have their feelings. Let them have it. Don't try to argue with them. Let them have. And there's probably a million different techniques that do this exact same thing. This is just happens to be the one that I've learned that I love. So witness, listen, let them have their feelings. Do not argue with them. Acknowledge it. Wow. Yeah, that's, you look sad. And so you're just that mirror. You look sad. You look frustrated. You look angry. You look mad. So you acknowledge what are their feelings and then you validate it. Oh, I'd be scared too. Yeah, that's scary. That is absolutely scary. Then here's the key to this working on small children that don't have this brain development. Then you ask them, can you feel that in your body? I have yet to ever find one that didn't say yes. Yeah, right here. Really, if it's right there, does it have a color? Blue. Is it light blue, dark blue, light blue? Oh, okay, so, and is it, how big is it? Is it this big, is it this big? It's this big, okay? What we have done is we have now made it physical. We have acknowledged it and validated it, and we have found where is it in their body. And when you do that, the rest of it I can't explain, except that the mind-body connection can resolve it. It can heal it. It can stop it. In 5 minutes, it was just over. It never came up again. I've since done it with kid after kid after kid. Right now, I'm working with a little boy, an adorable little boy in South Africa. And it's because of our time differences, we're doing it at 7:30 at night, his time. So, you know, he's tired and he gets frustrated really easily. So I noticed during, it's like our second session together, he was really getting mad at Mom. And so I asked him, Eliza, how are you feeling? And he said, I'm sad. I said, oh, you're sad. You look sad. I'm sad. And then he says, a boy at school said I can't play with this other boy, and he doesn't even know me. And I said, oh, that's awful. That's terrible. He doesn't even know you, and he won't let you play with the other boy? Yeah. Can you feel that in your body? Mm-hmm. Where is it? My heart. What color is it? Red. Okay. Is it, how big is it? This big? How big is it? About this big. And I swear, in like 10, 20 seconds, he's like, back to happy, and we go on with the session. So four times during the session, I had to stop and ask him, what are you feeling? And it was sad, angry, frustrated, and sad again. So pretty limited vocabulary, really super bright little boy, 6 years old, very, very amazing kid that's got some of these issues, can't stay on top. So his big thing was daydreaming. The same reflex that is about daydreaming, it also causes sibling disagreements, not getting along very well with your siblings. So we address that with particular exercises that all infants make at that stage, and then that gets better. So he's already not, so he was daydreaming all the time. He's no longer daydreaming. And he, what else did he reported? He was getting better at soccer, and I can't remember, he had a third thing that he was getting better at, but that's just 3 weeks in. So for him, the movements are really doing their job, so they always do.
So what does that empower?
Empower.
What does the empower piece look like as an older kiddo?
So the empower part of this, it happens as a result of this. You don't actually have to do anything. You get to hear, it will empower them.
Well, I'm just saying, I can't really see having the conversation of maybe where are you feeling it, but you know, what color is it and how big is it with my, you know, almost 13-year-old.
Uh-huh. Oh, actually, they're very good at it.
Well, I can see, you know, the dramatic eye rolls and stuff.
Yes.
Okay. Whereas if I do it,
treating me like a 6-year-old.
Yeah, right.
Sort of.
Whereas if I do it, they buy in. Paul, did.
So the way I see that is you can ask if you feel stressed or not. Is there tension?
Right, right.
Where do you feel the tension?
Right.
Okay. And now then you're asking the same question and giving the same answer, but you've used language that is
the
higher level language.
Yeah. Right, right.
So
right.
The conversation in the room is that if it's an older child and you think that they're going to think that you're treating them like a baby, you're going to use bigger language. You're going to use, are you feeling stress in your body? Where are you feeling it in your stress? And I want you to focus on that. And that works whether it's an adult or a child. It doesn't make any difference. It's going to help them process that emotion because they literally don't have this wiring. They can't process their emotions. This is purely physical development of the brain. If they don't have this wiring, they cannot process these grown-up emotions that are happening. They've got to get some help. So by identifying it in the body, the mind-body connection will process it over and over and over. We had one is a pair of twins. Most twins come in pairs, so that's convenient how that works. So we had a pair of twins that were 4 years old, and every day it was a nightmare when they'd come to the pre-K. They wouldn't get out of the car, so they had to physically carry them into the school because they would not leave the car. They did not want to go to school. And then they would be a limp rag. So they literally had to carry them from classroom to classroom because they were a limp. And they were really, really unhappy. So when I first got there, it was my turn. I was going to get my 20 minutes with them. And I'm coaching somebody else on how to do what we do. And we get in there, and he's and she's like, okay, let's get him in position. I said, no, let's see what his feelings are. Let's identify his feelings and let him have them. And so we did this, just very simple. You know, what are you feeling? I'm sad. My parents don't love me. They take me to school and drop me off every day. They hate me. For him, it was real. You know, I mean, it's real. Because think about this. They don't have much connection here. They can't get what we get that, oh, they've, let's see, they've put him in the best preschool in a couple of counties, you know, that they drive an hour each way to put them in this amazing school that's the best. They don't get that. They get, I don't want you anymore. Get out of the car, okay? So, processed his emotions. And then the next day, or the rest of that day, I mean, and it was the whole thing here, definitely less than 5 minutes. And then he is a happy camper. He's just, now he's getting balls out and he's starting to play with them. Now let's get him in position and we'll do some movements. We're good. So mom was so impressed with that. She's a surgeon. She was so impressed with that that she had me work on her other twin. And so we specifically let him pick, you can't all see this, but this fear paralysis reflex. We let them choose. We show them the different exercises and which ones are they attracted to, because that's our, we've learned for over the, we've been doing this 10 years. We've found the shortcut, and it is letting the kids pick. So he picked 3 fear paralysis movements. And again, these are super simple, something like this. Ooh, hard, right? But this is doing major things in the brain. So he does that. The next day, he opened the car door to get out before she had stopped. Okay? That's a shift. So when she saw that, then she had me work on her, because she's moving up in management level at the hospital where she's a surgeon, and she was really nervous about doing meetings and couldn't talk and would stutter, and her handwriting was really bad, so I worked on her, and then I ended up working on her husband's grandmother or something like that. So 4 family members, 3 generations. That's the only one I've got like that, but that's really exciting that we got to work on 3 different generations. But the same thing, we're still addressing the same thing. In that family, it was all, this fear paralysis reflex is what their family needed the most. And so we did that, and that addressed their problems. So far we've learned peacock feather to activate the parasympathetic nervous system, the wave, which helps them process heavy duty emotions so that they can get on with their lives, and so can you. It's gonna make your life a lot easier. And then the last one I want to teach you is called X Marks the Spot. And this is particularly good for sensory kids, anxiety, autism. This is our heavy hitter for everybody. So I'm going to have my husband Paul come up and help me. And we're going to be working right here on the massage table. So what we're gonna do is have Paul lay on his side. I'm gonna do X Marks the Spot. That was another one. Okay, so, and I need to be able to reach his hands and feet. So right now, usually we have them face down. Sometimes we have them face up. If they're too ticklish on the backs of the legs or there's some other reason, we'll flip them over. But most of the time we're gonna do this. And I call it X Marks the Spot, and that's because our arms and legs are the X. And then we have an I in the middle. So it's X and an I. So X marks the spot. We're always going to start in the center of the X. So that is above the belly button. That's our center of gravity. It's our body's center. And the first round, I'm just going to do palm over palm. And I'm going to ask him, am I pressing? So is this firm enough?
Yeah.
Okay, so you might have to press firmer, you might have to press lighter, but you ask them, you get their input, you know, do you want it harder or lighter? So then you're gonna go palm over palm, and I'm gonna go up to the shoulder, and then down the arm, and then I'm gonna get their fingertips. This is the key, it's not this part of the hand, it's the tips, we're the end of the nervous system, and I'm gonna compress, I'm gonna squeeze about a count of 7 and then a fast release. This is key, this fast release. If you don't do that, you're not going to get these results, okay? It is what it is. So then I'm going to go palm over palm back to my starting point. Now I can pick another limb. Doesn't matter which one. I'll go down this leg. Nice and firm. Down here, going to get to the end of the nervous system, the toes. I'm going to squeeze. Quick release. back up the leg, back to my starting and ending point. Always come back. So we're tracing the nervous system from the center to the extremities and back every time. So I'm going to go down the other leg. It doesn't matter the order in which you do these. Squeeze. Back to my starting place. I keep, this is important, so I'm going to keep repeating it because a lot of people will skip it. Get my tips in there. With a little hand, this is a lot easier, and their little bodies a lot faster. Quick release. Now I'm going back to my starting and stopping point. Now I'm going to do the eye. So I'm going to go up the spine. And I'm going to get to the top of the head. And this is almost more of the essence of a compression than an actual compression, because I don't want to mess with their upper cervical. So it's the intention of a compression. Fast release is still there. So that's the end of that part of the spine. Then I'm going to go down to the tailbone, and this is what almost all the kids love the most. And you can put some weight on this. Quick release back to the center. That's round one. So you're typically going to do three rounds. Probably five is about as many as I've ever needed to do. But you will see, so with kids with autism, they will, the experience has been that they get so relaxed and drooly and possibly asleep by the third to fifth round that mom's in tears because they've never been able to take a nap. They've never been able to relax like this because the reflexes were having them all hyped up. So this calms the nervous system. It's really good if you have kids that are hard to get to go to sleep. It will help them go to sleep. So this is a really good one to do right before bed, in the bed, and they'll fall asleep while you're doing it. And consistently, kids will ask for it. If you forget, if you get this started and then you try to skip it, they're going to ask for it. We had some clients that were recently, they did the Disney cruises over spring break, and they insisted on this during spring, during the cruise, that they needed this to go to sleep because it works. So there are variations to keep it interesting and fun. And if you're not trying to get them to go to sleep, you're still getting many benefits of the nervous system. But you can, this one is way more ticklish, but some kids just love this one. So you're going to do the la 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 la. You have to have sound effects. La 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 la. Squeeze, release. La 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 la. For kids with autism that don't want to be touched, we use puppets, we use stuffed animals, we'll use hula hoops or traffic cones or bean bags. It doesn't matter. I mean, because they will bring me all of the, here, do it with this, do it with this, do it with a magic marker, you know, like, So they will come up with a million different ways to do this. The most popular one needs no introduction. I recommend having water nearby because you will get so dehydrated, but they love this with the sound effects. The sound effects are key. Yes?
I'm curious whether you or your clients have tried this with time change, jet lag, addressing time changes in travel, like big time changes.
So the question is, have we ever used this to address time changes and time zone changes, things like that? And I'm sure that our parents have, but I don't have any memories of people talking about it. But they use it for everything. They'll use it in the car if they're having a meltdown at Walmart or something. They'll go out to the car, and they may not be able to lay down, but they will just track it all over their body to where they can, compress, release, and it calms the nervous system, and they will beg for it. So we came and did an event here.
Sensory story time.
And the kids who had done it got in line to do it again because it feels good. And I was only doing one round. Well, three rounds is three times better at least. They love doing this. Any questions about this? Now, I did not bring this feedback, this exercise handout, but I have a speaker feedback form that if you'll put X on there, I will email it to you. so that you've got the instructions for doing this particular exercise. Yes?
And just to be clear, because you mentioned about some people doing it in the car, and mm-hmm. So you could do it anywhere. It doesn't have to be on a table. It could be on the floor. It could be anything like that.
Bed, chair, car, anywhere. You could do it in a pool. You could do it anywhere that you can get access to their hands and feet. You can calm them down. It's impressive. It's just impressive. Yes?
I'm sorry, just didn't get the part of the hand that don't squeeze, but you was right down.
Yeah, because, you know, I just don't want to mess with the upper cervical. So I it's a very light press, and I think that I'm pressing into the spine. So it's going that way this time. I'm compressing the spine, but the quick release is still there. Whereas then we get down to the tailbone, and you can put some weight on here. I think I've had one child in all the kids we've ever worked on that I pressed too hard, and then do that quick release and come back. Any other questions about this before I release my sleepy assistant? Are you still there?
I'd be glad to lay here the whole
time. Oh, okay. Thank you. Oh, I should have put a sheet on there just for his drool. Okay, we have to wash the table. It's not too bad. Yeah, he did pretty well. Okay. All right. So I would like to see what other questions. And did I answer this to your satisfaction today? Did I cover what your issue was? Apparently so, because nobody's saying anything. Okay, any other questions about how this works?
Have you had any experience with this being successful for like toilet training issues or anything like that?
We have, very much so. The boy I was just telling you about that doesn't have the shoes and socks issues, he peed every 20 minutes all day long, which drove everybody around him nuts. It's over. It's completely over. Bedwetting is another reflex issue. So if they're bedwetting past age 5, then we address a reflex called spinal gallant, and we will stop the bedwetting. We've also had one of our clients, she was incontinent, which is a little bit different during the day. And for her, it was gluten's. And so we took her off of gluten's, and her parents said, oh, we can't tell any difference. And then she went to a birthday party and got a cupcake, and then there it was again. So it was like, oh, okay. So sometimes gluten's, and the other one is B12, as if there's a B12 deficiency, all kinds of different things can go on. And that can also, B12 deficiency triggers these reflexes too. Iron deficiency is typically gluten's because it's causing such an inflammatory process in the gut. I had pernicious anemia all of my life until I went gluten-free, and then it completely stabilized. And some kids, going gluten-free is not enough. If you go gluten-free and you don't see a significant change, and I mean quickly, I mean some kids, if there's a lot of aggression, you go off of gluten's, within 24 hours, you're gonna see a big shift, okay? If you don't, if you go a couple weeks and you don't see a significant shift, then you need to go grain-free. Because the problem is actually lectins. And lectins is a part of plants that is there to like make bugs not wanna eat it. It's a self-preservation. And there's a book out there called The Plant Paradox that teaches you about this. Gluten is a lectin. It's the worst one. It causes the most damage. But some kids are gonna do so much better if you just get them off of grains, and we've definitely had those. And if dairy-free is another place we typically go. And if you're only gonna do one dairy-free or gluten-free, do you have this? Do you have emotional roller coasters? If so, go dairy-free first. That's the one that does the emotional roller coasters. The other behaviors are often, the gluten's are a little bit more consistent. And, you know, we've had parents that said, oh, we tried going gluten-free, it didn't do anything. So I gave them a little chart that says, okay, when there's a meltdown, what are the last things they ate and what time? And what triggered it? You know, was it sibling thing? Was it possession? Was it tired? What was it? And they came back, and they're in less than a week, they're like, oh my God, it was gluten's. It's 3 hours later. He throws a total fit 3 hours later. That's the first one I've ever had that was so black and white about, it was a time thing. Because, and gluten's, I mean, it's usually about 3 days. For me, 2 weeks. It affects me for 2 weeks with depression. So I do not do glutens. I won't be doing glutens. And just a little note I just learned this week is that if you get real sourdough bread, the fermentation process eats the glutens. So it's sort of gluten-free. So some people can do that and it's okay. Yes?
Is that the bread without the accelerators for making it rise?
No, when it's fermented, it does have yeast. But I don't know enough about, I have not ever made that, so I don't know enough about sourdough bread to know. I just know that in the book it talks about how.
You always use a starter in there, and it takes about a week to really get it into a starter.
Okay, so she was saying that it takes a starter. I'm saying this for our viewers, that it takes a starter to make sourdough bread. So if you have that starter is what ferments the glutens and eats them up so that you can. And that's why I think a lot of people, when they go to Europe, they don't have problems with glutens. And for one thing, they're using better flours that aren't as genetically modified as ours and fermented. It makes a difference. More questions? Yes?
Will this help with kids with special needs, chromosomal abnormalities, things like that? I have a son with Down syndrome.
I have a client with Down syndrome.
And it's, I mean, it is what he has, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm a typical kid, but this will help for something.
It accelerates brain development. That's what we do. So for the one that I've got, he's getting emotional awareness. So now you can ask him, how does he feel? And he's going through the terrible twos. Terrible twos, there's a topic. So terrible twos is a normal, healthy development. We want it because it's this point where they become an individual and they step back from mom. I'm not mom, I'm a separate individual, and we want that. If they don't go through the terrible twos, when they grow up, they're gonna be a doormat. They're gonna get used and abused. It's not good. You really want them to go through the terrible twos. So when we work with a client that hasn't gone through the terrible twos, they're going to. It's a natural function of these reflexes that they're gonna go through the terrible twos. So I've got this, a 9-year-old who's going through the terrible twos right now, but so many other things. His speech has gotten so much better. I mean, I couldn't understand anything he said when we started. Now I can understand him. His speech therapist noticed an improvement the first week. His vocabulary has gotten huge. And the thing that his mom loves the most, his mom is an OT, the thing that she loves the most is that he comes home and tells her what his day was like. She said, I prayed for that. He never came home and told me anything. And now he comes home and he'll tell on himself. And she loves that. But there are challenges with going through the terrible twos at a later age too, right? But it's a very important step that we need to go through. We've had other chromosomal issues. We had a little girl, I can't tell her story, it's too unbelievable. I'll just say we got speech and the world changed and she's no longer in an extreme special needs school. So I think that we've run out of time, and I thank everybody for coming today. I'm gonna ask the people that are still here to fill out a speaker feedback form to let me know how am I doing, am I doing what you need, and if you want the handout, check that box and put X in there, and I'll send you the instructions for doing X marks the spot. So thank you very much for coming today.